I think that we are going through an extraordinarily unusual period as far as nuclear weapons and the issue of disarmament is concerned. Obviously, President Obama's initiative, hugely important. But even before that, before he was elected, a few months or a year or so before, what has been unusual about the current interest is, if I can put it this way, it hasn't just come from the usual suspects. It's not just been people who for very many years have been calling for serious work towards reducing nuclear weapons, possibly abolishing nuclear weapons. It began with Dr. Kissinger, not exactly a peacenik in the public mind. He and a number of other senior Americans who had been former defense secretaries and so forth, saying, really, there's just too many nuclear weapons in the world. To have a president who is as focused and as committed at such an early stage of his presidency as President Obama certainly creates opportunities that haven't existed for at least the last 10 years. Hugely important to have the non-proliferation treaty renewed. But it's also a realization that even if you believe in nuclear deterrence, you don't need as many weapons as we have at the moment. The United States and Russia, between them, have 95% of all nuclear weapons. They have about 5,000 strategic nuclear weapons each. Even if that was reduced to a couple of hundred, their relative position as between each other would remain the same. But the world would be a safer place, because the more nuclear weapons there are, the more fissile material there is, the greater the risk that some of it might get into terrorist hands or the hands of rogue states. And the discipline that is required with any dangerous weapon is that much more difficult to enhance. So that, I think, is the background why there is a lot of enormous goodwill, not just from left wing or right wing or conservative or Labour, but across the political spectrum. The issue of whether we ever get to zero, actually abolish nuclear weapons completely. First of all, these steps have to be multilateral. There is no point in expecting or asking any one country to give up its nuclear weapons regardless of what others are doing. Secondly, we have to realize it will take quite a lot of time, even if we ever get to that stage. The delivery of this policy will be quite an important challenge. The key is the United States and Russia, because they have 95% of the total. But at some stage, if they are successful, other nuclear powers, the United Kingdom, France, China, India, Pakistan, will also have to be part of the equation. There is a discussion in the United Kingdom about whether we should continue with Trident. Let me be quite clear, as my own view is that there can be no question of expecting the United Kingdom or any other country to give up its nuclear weapons in a vacuum. If we can reach the stage where all countries, over a progressive period of time, are reducing and removing their nuclear weapons, then the United Kingdom must play its part. What is crucial to multilateral disarmament is, firstly, proper verification and transparency. If you are going to be giving up or reducing your nuclear weapons, you have to be pretty certain, not just on balance, but beyond reasonable doubt, that your potential adversaries are also giving up their nuclear weapons and not cheating. And that becomes more important the more you reduce the number of weapons. If you're an American with 5,000 nuclear weapons and you're going down to 2,000, the fact that the Russians may secretly stay at 3,000 is not the end of the world. Once you get down to a few dozen, once you're coming down, if you ever reach that stage, to 5 or 10, then if the other side's cheating, if you've got zero and he's got one, which is indeed where the United States was in 1945, at the time of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, then that is a very profound difference. In the kingdom of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. So verification and transparency are just not just words. You have to be absolutely satisfied, which in the modern world with modern technology is becoming a lot easier. The other issue, which is a very difficult one, whatever your philosophical beliefs might be, is that, of course, one of the reasons we had nuclear weapons during the Cold War wasn't just to deter a nuclear power from attacking us with its nuclear weapons. It was actually also to prevent another Third World War with conventional weapons. We know that the First World War, the Second World War, didn't use nuclear weapons until the very, very end in 1945, but hundreds of millions of people still died. So the whole point of nuclear weapons was to prevent any major war, world war, breaking out. And broadly speaking, it's been successful. Now, the concern that some have is if you get rid of nuclear weapons, okay, that's very good, but might we actually go back to the bad old days of conventional wars, something like the First World War breaking out again? The other problem, of course, is Russia. Russia is the other major nuclear power. And we can't assume that Russia will be as supportive as President Obama would be. Russia is a far weaker country than it was in the old days when it was the Soviet Union. Then it was one of the two world superpowers. Russia today is light years behind the United States as regards its military power. The one thing that still enables the Russian government to think it's a world leader are its nuclear weapons. That's what distinguishes it from many other countries. And it is not just a question of prestige. From a Russian perspective, if, let's say, one day you got rid of nuclear weapons, today the United States' conventional strength is so much vaster than that of any other country, including Russia. Russia really would be relatively weak because its conventional military forces today are not very impressive. I don't think in practice it makes a huge difference, but in terms of diplomacy, in terms of the power debates within the Kremlin, we can't assume that Russia will simply agree with mutual reductions to a much lower level. It might one day, but it's by no means to be taken for granted. So these are issues which I think statesmen, as opposed to ideologues, have to be conscious of and recognize that goodwill is not sufficient. I'm a politician, not an archbishop, and therefore that doesn't mean one is against hope or one doesn't have hopes and visions. Of course, that's also part of politics. But I think if you have a political background, and if you have been, as I've been fortunate in being a defense minister and a foreign minister, then you mustn't just get too visionary. People will say, well, with your background, we want to hear from you. How practical is this? What are the risks? What are the problems? Can it be delivered? Are you completely sold on this idea? Or, you know, tell us the problems, not just the opportunities. And that doesn't mean you don't have vision. It doesn't mean you don't offer hope. But it means that your main contribution is to try and share with people your best practical assessment as to the strengths and weaknesses of what is on the table. I think that is a more viable contribution than simply flights of rhetoric. President Obama is very good at that.